Hello YouTube viewers, welcome to my show Science Thursday. In today's episode, we're gonna take a look at high voltage direct current transmission. So let's dive right into it. First thing we have to understand, if I'm talking about DC, we have to understand why the heck we use AC. So there is a very serious relationship between voltage and amperage. So if you have the same quantity of watt, you change any one, it will affect the other. So let's say you increase the voltage, it automatically will decrease the voltage if the watt is same. So why do we want to increase the voltage and reduce the amperage? Very simple. Every conductor, unless it's a superconductor, has what we call resistance. Resistance plus amperage equals basically heat that is generated. So if you reduce your amperage, your conductor will be cold. If you don't do that, if you dump like let's say a lot of current through your conductor, problem would be that because of the heat generated, the conductor will lose basically its conductivity over time. It will like, you know, first it will heat up to like 50 degrees Celsius, then it will lose little bit of, you know, conductivity, then it will heat up even more. It will never become non-conductive. So it's inherent property of metal. So do not think like, you know, if it heats up too much, it's not gonna conduct. It's the resistance of it that will go exponentially high. And that's why we have cooling with everything. So to make sure that you don't need, you know, gigantic refrigeration unit with each conductor, we want to reduce the ampere that goes into it. To do easiest way to do that is increase the voltage if you have the same amount of power. So that's why we do it. Now the sole reason why we use AC instead of DC is very simple, thanks to these puppies. Now these puppies are called transformers, and as many you can see, it is very simple. It has no moving part. In principle, all it is just because AC has on and off, it is creating magnetic field that is changing. It's not creating a static magnetic field. So once the magnetic field is created, it's collapsed. It created, collapsed, collapsed, created, collapsed. So it's acting like a generator basically. So that's why we can use transformer on an AC current. You can't use the transformer on a DC simply because even if you did that, the moment you turn it on, it will act like a transformer. The moment the whole coil is energized, it's not going to turn off like, you know, in the DC current. It's like, okay, yeah, for one spike you got the transformer to work, other than that it won't work. It won't work continuously because of the inherent nature of AC that is going on and off, on and off, on and off 50 times a second or 60 times a second, you get a transformer that is working. This is the whole reason we use AC, nothing else. So is there a consequence of that? We are using AC for around 100 years. So are there any consequences of this? Yes. First very big consequence is that it has what we call skin effect. Now skin effect simply means if you have a conductor, like it's a big cylinder like that, if you send AC current to it, because of the nature that it's creating a magnetic field and collapsing the magnetic field, it won't penetrate deep enough. So the core of the conductor simply won't be carrying any electricity. Now it won't be like, you know, if you probe it that place directly, it will have zero current going through it, but it will be very less. So all the current generally tries to go through the outside. Now higher your frequency, the worse that effect becomes. So if you, let's say for aircraft industry, we generally use what we call 300 hertz. So basically the frequency of that is 300 hertz. It's going on and off 300 hertz. Most of the places in the world generally are at 50 hertz. So the reason why they use 300 hertz is simply because if you have higher frequency, your transformer works much more effectively, meaning your motors will become smaller, your transformer will become smaller. So for a aircraft, because aircraft are not very big, so they don't have to worry about transmitting the power for very long distance. It's barely 1 kilometer of wiring, like power wiring. I'm not talking every little small wire. If you connect that, that will be big. But because of this skin effect, even though you may have a thick cable, it won't be able to be utilized properly. For that reason, if you see any power line, there is a very good chance you will spot power lines, especially with high capacity one, where even though they have like three phase, you will see each phase itself will be carrying multiple conductors, like these three conductors, four conductors, whatever it may be. Some big ones have six or eight. The reason for that is that you can't use a thicker wire. It simply won't be utilized. Second, it has to transmit power plus apparent power. That's why all your transformer is rated in KVA, basically kilovolt amps. They are not rated in like, you know, kilowatt, simply because due to the nature of electricity itself, while it's in a, you know, alternating state, basically AC, there is a basic every time you turn on a motor or every time you turn on anything having a transformer, like a electric arc welder or things like that, they need a bit of jolt to, you know, start them. Now, while they are running, you still have to send that jolt. So basically, this becomes your power requirement that is actually doing the work, plus the power that is perceived to push things along. Now, this is very complex. All you have to understand is that you have to send the power. Let's say your consumer is demanding 50 kilowatt. You can't send 50 kilowatt. You have to send 50 kilowatt plus the apparent power and power factor correction. Then you will get a mathematical number. Okay, so if my consumer is taking 50 kilowatt, like as in that's their use, you have to send roughly 60 to 65 kilowatt. So there is a very serious wastage inherent to this system. You can't do anything about it. This is inherent. Yes, you can improve your power factor correction and that way increase efficiency, but you can't really make the power factor go away. It always be there. You can reduce it or make it higher, but you can't make it go away. Then because the cable itself is acting like a capacitor, if you had a very long cable, as in like 3000 or 5000 kilometer long cable, it simply won't transmit the power on the other end. Even though you can send a very high voltage, that you know from doing the mathematics that given the resistance of the cable, it should go to the other end, it won't. Because of the cable acting like a capacitor, it will try to charge the capacitor and it's gonna lose all the energy. It's not a big deal when you are talking about, like, you know, 1 kilometer or 100 kilometer or 500 kilometer, but if you are talking about 1000 plus, yeah, then it becomes an issue. Because everything, every cable itself, basically every line of conductor that you have is acting like a capacitor. This happens because of the AC nature itself. So because the capacitance is getting attenuated, so at the other end you won't even get any power. Now, you can't put these cables underground, especially these high voltage ones. Now, you can put low power ones underground without much loss, but if you have more energy going through it, the more energy would be lost because of the ground around it, because it's creating a magnetic field that is not static. It's not like it created the magnetic field and that's it. It's going on and off, on and off, on and off. The consequence of that is Earth is taking much more energy away. So many of you have heard that, you know, if you have underground cable, they don't last as long. Many of you must have wondered, like, why the heck it's sealed from the atmosphere, it's sealed from the, you know, rain, it's sealed from, why the heck it's, you know, getting destroyed so quickly. Like, they are giving you 50-year warranty if you have the same cable, on high voltage lines, but if you bury it underground, they're giving you 25-year warranty. What's happening here? Simply because Earth is taking so much energy away from the magnetic flux or the capacitance that you have to send more power. Now, if you send more power, your ampere goes up. If your ampere goes up, your cable heats up. That's why the cable dies so quickly. So it is not a very comfortable or a wise idea to dump AC line inside. Low power, not an issue. But if you want to dump these, you might be wasting so much power that you wouldn't even realize. And if you are doing undersea, forget anything about above 30 kilometers. Like, flat out, you can't send AC power more than 30 kilometers. Now, this is not an absolute limit. Like, you can reduce the hertz, so you will reduce the skin effect, and you can do some mitigation factor. But we are talking about normally, generally, like 50 hertz or 60 hertz, you forget about it. 30 kilometers is your limit. So, what are the pros of DC? If AC has that many consequences, what are the pros of DC? First, it's a very efficient in terms of conductor use. So let's say you give one thick conductor, it's going to use that whole conductor. You're going to give multiple small conductor, it's going to use that multiple small conductor. One thick conductor is easy to manufacture, easy to maintain, especially if it's underground, and all things considered, you won't waste a lot of central area. So it's very efficient. Given the same amount of matter, it's much more effectively using it. No skin effect. Second, we come to the fact how far it can go. Now, of course, as I said, in DC also, when you turn the system on, there will be a time where where it's trying to energize the entire cable. It will take some energy away from that, but it won't be continuous, because AC, unlike AC, where it's going on and off, on and off, on and off, DC doesn't do that. It's like on. So DC can go very far, depending on voltage. Like, at that time, only thing that is drawing your electricity away from you is resistance. So it has no attenuation of itself. Like, of course, your resistance, unless you are using superconductor, you're gonna lose power, but it won't be like, okay, my resistance calculation showed that I should be able to send electricity to, like, let's say 1500 kilometer, but at 800 kilometer my power rating is coming to zero. That's those sort of thing won't happen. then because of the nature of DC itself, it does not have to worry about what we call inherent power, active power, power factors. None of those things have to worry. So when you design a DC system or DC conductor, it's simply rated for what it is. There is real power that is being transmitted here. So you don't have to waste power like trying to correct the magnetic issues of a substation. So let's say you sending DC power to a substation is going to utilize it to its fullest extent. You don't have to oversend them because they themselves will have a lot of power factor. So that's why it's very efficient at transmitting. Then we come to the fact that it can be underground. Now, underground cable, as you can see in this, if it's an AC cable, you cannot make this cable very thick because at the end it will, because of skin effect, it will be wasteful. But in this, you don't have to do that. So it can be very easily underground because it's not, it's gonna energize only at once, like when you turn it on. Once it's energized, it's not gonna bleed energy. It's like 30-40% more efficient per kilometer, per 1,000 kilometer compared to AC system. And on sea, like if you have what we call offshore wind farms, as you can see in a picture like this, they can only send the power to shore by using DC system. They cannot send it using AC system. So all the switching station that you see here, so the turbines are making AC, so the AC is going very short distance, so it can do that. So from here to sea, sea side, it's taking a very long path. It could be as long as 600 kilometers. That cannot be done on AC, so they do DC. And as you realize that world has two segments, which we call ANSAT and PAL for video folks, and simply it means half of the world is running on 50 hertz, other half is running on 60 hertz. So 60 hertz is America and all that, and everything else is basically what we call 50 hertz. All things considered, you don't have to worry about it. Like, let's say you have offshore wind farm, you can send to both of them. You can be like, hey, take the power, like you convert it to whatever you need to. And this can be connected to any source. This is very crucial. Any of you who have worked with power plants or very serious power generation, especially like solar farms, you can check my video on that here. That you have to realize that because of the wave nature of AC current, it has to be synchronized, and I mean perfectly synchronized. Basically each wave have to be linked to other wave, and there are three waves. Like, basically generally they have three phase electricity for common consumption. So you have to make sure each of your phase is mixed properly, and the phase angle is correct, everything is correct, voltage should be correct, the frequency should be correct. In DC, you don't have to worry about this. Now in AC, what will happen if you screw this up? You can roast the whole transformer. And that would be the lucky outcome. Worst outcome is you can damage the equipment at the consumer side, especially induction motors. So the fact that this allows to be the electricity that you are creating, let's say an independent company is creating electricity in the sea, it can sell it to anyone. They don't have to worry about making the power sync up. They're like, okay, this is my DC power, take it and do whatever you want. On your end, you convert it to whatever you need specific to your grid. So this is why you can connect any sort of source, power source, to a DC network, but you can't do that to AC network. Specifically, AC network that has frequency, that has freaking phase angles. So all things combined, DC to DC connection is very easy, but DC to AC connection, very that's also relatively easy. AC to AC connection is very complex. You have to maintain it very, very closely. So if DC is all well and good, then why don't we use DC all the time? First, we don't have the cheap technology. Like, I could literally say we don't have the technology, and that would be correct, but we can do it. But the cost of the equipments that we need right now, it's idiotically high. So as you can see, this is a man, and this is the size of the component. These are bigger than the size of the components that you need for a normal AC system. And this whole thing even became possible because of mercury arc valves. Yeah, they are mercury. There is mercury in that, and actual mercury, not little bit. Actual mercury is there. So these are quite complicated equipment. Not to mention, they don't last very long because, as I already told, in transformer there is no moving part. Here there are many moving parts sometimes, and you may have arc valves and all that. Only now with current technology we can do what we call solid state. Earlier we didn't have that technology. So there are two things that you have to do. First, you have to take the AC, make it to DC if your generator is making AC power. Second, you have to convert that DC back into AC, because we're not going to change AC to consumer. This is about transmitting the power. This is not about changing your home appliance from DC, you know, AC to DC. We're not going to do that. We're never going to do that. But the way we sell power to you, like basically from a coal-fired power plant or a wind power plant or a, you know, solar farm or a hydropower plant, to you, it will be sent to, you know, using DC to your nearest substation. From substation to you, it will be AC again. So you have to figure out two conversion. Conversion number one, where you have the AC source and you convert into DC. Second, you have DC to AC. And it's not like, you know, normal inverter. You have to make sure that it's three phase, and you also have to make sure it's perfectly synced with the, you know, that what is coming in. Now, biggest reason why these components are so huge is simply because we want to use high voltage. If we don't use voltage, we end up increasing the amperage, and amperage has a lot of side effect. So if you increase the voltage too much, you also end up with a problem where you've seen the waveform of three-phase AC, there is a lot of overlap. But when you scale up, like from 0 to 200, that's a wave like this, but from 0 to 20 million voltage, the wave is very sharp. For that sharp, so even though you can have, like, you know, in these sort of scenario, what they use, what we call six phase electricity, they take three phase electricity, they do a phase transform on that, so now three phase electricity becomes six phase electricity, then they switch, send it to a bridge rectifier. The bridge, it's a full bridge rectifier. From that rectifier, they get almost 12 phases, but still the gap between the phases, because the waves are so long, it's very high. They need capacitor that is literally the size of a big building, very big. So for that reason, conversion from AC to DC is not that easy. Now you might be like, okay, then why don't we directly use DC? Like, you know, use DC generator in wind farm, DC generator, you know, solar cells are DC itself. The problem is that we don't have any technology right now, as I talk to you, to take DC to bump it up to ultra high voltage DC. So the best we can do is take the DC that is low power, like let's say each unit of your farm is giving you, let's say 1 megawatt, you take that low power, take that you know, in AC power, then you bump it up to super high voltage, then you convert that. So for this reason, we still are kind of lacking behind it, the technology. And that's the easy aspect. The hard aspect is, again, converting that DC back to AC that is three phase, that is perfectly synced and not square wave. Those are the tricky aspect that requires some serious investment, some serious technology. And these things that we have been running for last 30 to 50 years, they don't last very long. Sometimes the whole power plant actually have a backup system ready to go because these things are so unreliable. Transformers don't have moving parts, so they can be like completely isolated and they will work very effectively. So we still have some serious consequences with DC. However, all of these will be solved in the next few coming years, simply because our technology is getting better. Now, what we can expect in the future is that we're gonna shift to ultra high voltage direct current. Now, right now, when I say high voltage DC, I'm talking about 800 kV, 800, basically 800 kilovolt. Now, in the future, anything that will exceed 1 megavolt, as in 100,000 voltage, it's gonna be classified as ultra high voltage. The higher the voltage, the better it is. Now, once we reach that high voltage, the problem is that these sort of structures become kind of very problematic, simply because if you have high voltage that is close enough to ground, it's directly gonna jump. It simply is gonna jump. So that's why we don't directly go super high. So that's why the from substation to your transformer is generally at 1100 volt, because those cables are not very high. So if they send that very high current voltage, they can send it, but problem is it's gonna arc. And any building that is, you know, close by, it's gonna arc. Any plant that goes close by, it's gonna arc. For that reason, these towers that carry very, very, very high voltage, they are very tall. For this reason, especially if you are going above river where, you know, boats can be traveling, metal objects can be traveling, they have to make sure it's very far off. So we have to make sure we use DC and we bury it underground. That way we can solve the arcing issue. And that will also allow us, if it's properly sealed, properly built, we can keep boosting the voltage without changing the conductor. So in the future, we're gonna have underground and undersea entire grid. Now this grid won't connect to you. This grid will be for power plants. There's basically everybody who's generating power, they will dump their power into this DC grid. As I already said, it's very easy to sync up. You don't have to worry about any syncing up. All you have to do is like, okay, this is my polarity and this is my, you know, voltage. Done. You don't have to worry about anything other than that. So it's quite easy. Any power plant can dump it, rather than like, you know, trying to make sure their frequency never drifts, you know, when they are connected to national grid. So all things considered, we're gonna have a very you know, underground kind of infrastructure. And wherever you have big cities, there you will see a you know, tunnel where, you know, the power line is coming off and it's going to substation. From substation to your home, it will be exactly the same. We simply won't have these sort of lines, but from your substation to your current location, it will be more or less the same. And this is going to reduce the land uses. As many of you know, India soon will reach 2 billion people in terms of population. China is also, you know, going towards it. So we're going to need land, and we can't just waste this. As you can see, you can't build anything nearby. You can't build any large structure nearby without risking arcing. And not to mention, government already had purchased the land. Like, that whole strip of land has been purchased. So for these sort of reason, underground grid is much more effective and useful for us. And these also cause pollutions. I mean, like, how the heck they call it? Because of the magnetic field of electricity itself, it causes what we call coronal discharge. Now, it's not as big as what you see in the North Pole or South Pole of Earth, because Earth's magnetic field is surprisingly huge, but they still cause it. They generate a little bit of ozone, which can cause a harmful effect to health. For that reason, burying it underground is also beneficial. Then we come to the fact that soon India has already invested a lot of money in it, and China had to do it simply because China's energy source was in Himalayas and people were living near to what we call a seaside, basically they're coastal. So the gap between these two were around 3,000 to 4,000 you know, kilometer. AC simply cannot travel that far. So right now what we use for DC is very simple, a backbone connection. Basically, power is generated from point A and then sent to point B. That's it. We don't have a grid of DC right now yet, because of the technology limitation. But soon we'll have grid of DC, especially for the power producer. It will not affect you, but it will be for producers. Then soon, right now, ABB, a company that is you know, pioneering, leading, almost like Siemens in DC system, they have also pioneered what we call small scale DC systems, because not everybody is gonna, you know, want to build a 50,000 megawatt solar farm. So for that sort of reason, you have to make sure your system is compatible enough with small scale also, where you have only few megawatts. Now, I don't think it will go very low. So I think the smallest scale that will be feasible would be 100 megawatt. So in future, we're gonna have underground DC network, and then we're gonna have normal AC. So this was my presentation about grid of the future. I hope you liked it or learned from it. In that case, please leave a like, share it amongst your friends, and I would urge you to subscribe. If you didn't, don't worry about it, dislike it, and leave a comment what we want to see in the next episode of Science Thursday. And press the bell icon if you are free. And as always, thanks for watching.